Welcome. I'm Ed Bride, president of Berkshires Jazz Incorporated. In association with the Mahaiwe Performing Arts Center, we've assembled a cross-section of the jazz community to explore guitar influences in jazz. It's a broad subject suitable for various perspectives. Joining us today, we have professional musicians, educators, advocates and fans, and of course, knowledgeable media representatives. The idea for this panel grew from the appearance of John Pizzarelli at the Mahaiwe this month. You know, John, along with his father, Bucky, represents jazz royalty. Their family comprises one of the few household names in the jazz world today. While the performance inspired the idea for this panel, it really isn't about any one musician or family, but rather about the instrument and its changing role in jazz, America's cultural gift to the world. This panel is the result of a collaboration between the Mahaiwe Performing Arts Center and Berkshire's Jazz, and is made possible in part by a grant from the National Endowment for the Arts. Participating in today's discussion, Jason Ennis, Berkshire's-based guitarist and teacher, and who has a diverse background in jazz, blues, Brazilian music, and classical music. He's in demand as a soloist, sideman, bandleader, and musical director, and Jason lectures on jazz guitar and popular styles at Dartmouth College. And closer to home, he's on the faculty of the Berkshire Music School. He leads a world jazz trio, Avos de Trey, and will be releasing his first CD as a leader in the coming year. Joe Smith, musician, educator, and board member of Berkshire's Jazz, is known as a bass player, composer, arranger, music director, and concert producer, as well as an educator. He's been a professor and dean at Berklee College of Music, and currently is co-chair of both the Education Committee and Program Committee of Berkshire's Jazz, in which capacity he has worked on jazz pedagogy with Berkshire's arts educators. Tom Lucci combines his love for jazz and radio with solid leadership in the corporate, small business, and nonprofit worlds. Since 2014, Tom has been host of Standard Time on WICN-FM, Worcester's NPR affiliate, broadcasting Jazz Plus in central New England. Tom has been a WICN board member since 2004, serving as president from 2010 to 2015, and interim general manager from 2015 to 2017. And he's also a saxophonist, or saxophonist if you prefer, in regional ensembles. Eli Newberger is a musician, music reviewer, and pediatrician of national acclaim. An accomplished tuba player, he was a co-founder of the New Black Eagle Jazz Band and currently performs regionally with his Hot Six traditional jazz band. You can see his reviews in the Berkshire Edge. Eli is the author of several papers and books, including The Men They Will Become. Okay, welcome back. As I said earlier, this is a very broad subject, and I wanted to give a little bit of context to how we got here in guitar and its various influences. And so we've asked Jason Ennis to sort of say some introductory remarks and your perspective. And I know you've taught subjects like this at Dartmouth and so forth. So let's go for your wisdom and insights.
So the quick whirlwind history of jazz guitar. How many minutes do I have? The Eddie Lang is credited as being the father of jazz guitar. In the 20s, he established the guitar as the primary rhythm instrument in big bands, orchestras at the time, leading the shift away from the banjo. He also was quite known as an accompanist for singers and violinist Joe Venuti. He accompanied Bing Crosby, right, on a bunch of stuff. He also is credited as playing the first single line solos on recordings. But I think the guitar kind of stays in a little bit of an accompaniment role, really kind of throughout the 30s. The big voice we look to being Freddie Green, rhythm guitar player in the Basie Orchestra. So at that time, that was before amplification, right? And so the guitar players were playing, Freddie Green would be playing quarter notes, chang, 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 you know, like strumming quarter notes with the strings really high off the fingerboard, playing pretty loud to project at all through the bassy band. And you might not even necessarily hear him on some recordings when the band is really driving hard, right, playing rhythm guitar like that. But the band would miss him if you weren't there. In fact, I was just a few days ago, I was hanging out with one of my dear friends and teachers, Gene Bertoncini, who's a good friend of the Pizzarellis, actually. And he has a great story about recording with some configuration of the bassy band with some other group that he ended up playing guitar with bassy band and the bassy rhythm section. And I can't remember who the drummer was at the time, but, and Gene's a great rhythm player. And between one of the takes, the drummer turned to the bass player and said, "Where's Freddie?" Yeah. Young Gene was like, But so, you know, it was a really more felt than maybe heard. The real big kind of breakthrough solo voice is Charlie Christian, who's credited as being the first electric guitar player, electric guitar soloist. He wasn't really the first electric guitar player. There were other people doing it. In fact, Les Paul was right, you know, Les Paul actually writes about picking up amps together with Charlie Christian from the Gibson factory, you know. And so they were doing it at the same time, but the thing that Charlie Christian did was he was playing kind of horn-like single line melodies in his solos. At a time when, so this was, you know, 1939, 1940, 41, I think he died. His language sounds more like the direction that the horn players were going with their improvisation. This is as swing music is transitioning to bebop music. Miles Davis told John Scofield that Charlie Christian was one of the main voices in that transformation. Charlie Christian was very active. Not only he was made great recordings with Benny Goodman, but he was also hanging out a lot at Minton's in Harlem, which was kind of one of the main cradles of the bebop language. This is kind of an interesting thing maybe we can talk about too, is there's almost like two tracks we can talk about influence of the guitar in jazz. There's influence of guitarists in the world of guitar, you know. Guitarists tend to have their own little world, right? You know, Eli and I were talking about, I used to hang out a lot in New York at Jack Wilkins' gig. We'd have Bucky Pizzarelli or Gene Bertoncini or Howard Alden play, and it's all guitar players hanging out, right? There's a community, you know, and there's almost a tradition within the subset of the jazz tradition, the guitar tradition. And then there's certain players there's a lot of influential players within that tradition that influence one another. And there's certain voices that really pop out and pop through and affect the wider jazz world in terms of the development of language. Charlie Christian, I would say, is probably one that did both of those. Obviously, was a huge influence on guitarists, but also was one of the voices in developing new language for the idiom as a whole. You know, after in the 50s, 40s, 50s, there's a lot of great guitarists. I mean, I don't know, we can talk about Django, how he fits into this. Django Reinhardt, great gypsy player from France. You know, Johnny Smith, Chuck Wain, who played with George Shearing's group, Barney Kessel, who did beautiful stuff, the Julie London duos, you know, this beautiful accompaniment. But you know, the next real like breakthrough voice is
Herb Ellis.
Herb Ellis, right? Herb Ellis, of course. Herb Ellis, especially with Oscar Peterson, he's kind of like Freddie Green on steroids, you know. You know, that trio with Ray Brown, Oscar Peterson, Herb Ellis. I mean, Herb's just the most driving, funky rhythm guitar player ever. I mean, I love it. Those two guys. I feel like, you know, are my favorites for rhythm guitar playing. And then Herb's also just a virtuoso single line player, burning. Oscar Moore, of course, with the early That group, the Peterson group, was coming out of the early Nat King Cole trio with Oscar Moore on guitar. Similar kind of vibe. Another one of my favorites. But the next big landmark is Wes Montgomery, right? Wes Montgomery kind of changes everything. His sound is so strong. Very interesting technique, playing just with his thumb, playing in octaves all the time. And a really dominant voice of the late 50s and the 60s. But then again, I mean, Wes is really influential for guitar players, but a lot of his stuff wasn't necessarily groundbreaking in terms of the rest of the world of jazz. You know, his major recordings were in the 60s, right? The Smokin' on the Half Note with the Wynton Kelly Trio. Right? Wynton Kelly Trio broke off from they were Miles Davis's rhythm section until they decided they wanted to kind of hang in this elegant swinging 50s thing when Miles was off to work with Herbie Hancock and Wayne Shorter and develop this new sound in the 60s, right? And so there, you know, Wes's thing is a little bit of a throwback in a way, even though it's, you know, some of my favorite stuff, right? The 70s is really kind of where things, for me, like really explode with guitar being a really important dominant voice overall. You know, coming out of Wes Montgomery, you have Pat Metheny, who was a Wes Montgomery clone when he was 14. The guys in Kansas City said, no, you have to make your own thing. So he definitely created his own thing, his own style. And he's a guy I look to who's, I mean, he really changed the landscape of jazz totally, right? The bigger picture, right? Obviously, a little before that, Jim Hall in the 60s, his harmonic concept that was recognized by Sonny Rollins, who grabbed him for the Bridge record, right? His harmonic concept was really kind of groundbreaking for and kind of helped define that era. You know, later in the 70s, you have John McLaughlin doing the fusion stuff, the fusion with Indian music, that kind of thing. Later, guys like John Scofield come along. You know, and now I feel like guys a little older than I am or younger, now the guitar is some of the most exciting stuff happening in the world of jazz. You know, you have guys like Ben Monster, you know, he's just like blowing everybody's mind. Kurt Rosenwinkel, really developing new language. Gilad Hexelman, Lage Loon, these guys. Julian Lage, is he been at the Mahaiwe yet? I don't know. Who's just an amazing voice in modern jazz guitar. Another one of my favorite guitarists who came on the scene in the 70s is Ralph Towner, who's coming out of, he was actually a pianist early, Bill Evans style pianist, studied classical guitar, worked with the Paul Winter consort, and his concept is really amazing, very interesting harmonically, his composition, taking in a lot of different influences, world music, classical music, jazz influences. So that's kind of, I mean, there's a lot of people we could talk about, and we will, but that's, you know, a quick, maybe not so quick, overview of you know, what we're working with. Well,
provide a good setting for us, yeah. So I want to talk to Joe a little bit, or ask him about, so you're a, I don't know if you prefer to be known more as a bass player or a composer and a writer, but as in both roles, you face all these years of influences, and the guitar is a major influence. Right. And I gather guitar influenced your playing as well. And maybe you can talk a little bit about all of these things. How does this affect what you do, and what do you think about this evolution? Does it make sense to you?
Well, I grew up sort of, my perspective is as a musician, but not as a guitar player.
Right.
That's a great question. So for the first part of my life, that makes me just another person, like everybody else. You know, starting with television just came along, and you watched anything, it was all live. Yeah. And I loved music right away. Even little. So you would hear studio orchestras live on television. You would hear everything. Lawrence Welk live. Everything was live. Then rock and roll came along, and Pittsburgh had a great radio station, KDKA, not only for listening to the Pirates on, but music. And when Motown hit, something hit me with that. So all those tunes were really thought through and arranged, had arrangers.
And great guitar players.
And great guitar players, and a great bass player,
Amen.
One of the great bass players.
Jamerson.
Yeah, Jamerson. But I was a French horn player, and that's what I was gonna be. Yeah. And playing all sorts of music, but I was really intrigued by studio musicians and accompanying everybody, jazz artists or you name it. And when I graduated from college in 1968, I shouldn't have said that. Okay, now you know how old I am. I played in the American Wind Symphony in Pittsburgh, and we had a bunch of visiting artists, and one of them was Oliver Nelson. So he was there for a week, and he gave us, he had seminars on the blues and writing and you name it, and he performed on soprano sax, and we accompanied him doing the Afro-American suite.
Yeah.
And it just really lit me up. I think, wow, this is something. And so that was the summer that Wes Montgomery died. And so I felt like I needed to explore that. And he and some of the other jazz musicians were starting to play music that was more commercial and work with Creed Taylor, and Don Sobeski was the arranger.
Oh, yeah.
And that went through this period of just things that I loved through the guitarist Freddie Hubbard and you name it. At the same time, then I had to go into the service, and that was when sort of the British thing was really catching fire. And they were the ones that really brought our attention to the old blues players, the Muddy Waters, guitar players, Muddy Waters, right. and Buddy Guy, people like that. And so then becoming aware of that, and then the bands had Eric Clapton and Peter Townsend and all that. So really, all of a sudden now, you had to pay attention to guitar players, no matter what you were doing. At least, you know, my world was classical music and R&B and you name it, but these guitar players. And then there was Jimi Hendrix. I mean, how could you not just, you know, get caught up with Jimi Hendrix? So after that, I went back to Berkeley to study composition and arranging. And there's Mike Stern, John Schofield, Bill Frisell, all these people, and all of a sudden, my whole attitude to the guitar was like, man, these guys are serious. And then that became what you were talking about. These people, instead of thinking of them as potentially a side person or a strong side person, they were the leaders. You know, they started developing their own thing. They were leaders leading in, from my perspective, technology, whatever that was, compression and looping and all that. And I eventually got into music technology.
Right.
And the whole thing is just progressed, and now it's where I feel like it's what you said, that these people are some of the people I really listen to. Pat Metheny, the genre, the things they actually create, these big spectrums. I worked in film for a while, film music for a while, and some of that, his music just reminds me of that. You know, it's just these large scoped orchestrations, even though they do it with smaller numbers
developed
of people.
Developed ideas and all this stuff.
Yeah, so. And I've been fortunate to get to know some of these guys and to get to know Jason, who is as good as any of them, in my opinion. He's an amazing guitarist. And it's really become, I feel like, a driving force in music.
When you talk about, and I think maybe everybody could comment on this, when you talk about Mike Stern and Schofield and all the rest of the current jazz guitar players today, are we at risk calling this jazz? Or should we not even use that word anymore because it's basically American blues-based improvisational music or some other long term? Is it jazz or do we really care? You know,
Are we supposed to keep this to an hour?
Well, yeah. Okay. Well, let me lay that in front of Tom, because Tom, having been both a musician and an acting station manager and now an on-air person, how do you listen to something and say, can I play this on a jazz show? I mean, is it all the names that he's, everybody that's been named so far going to be on your show?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. From my particular show, the format that is we're playing, really try to focus on the American songbook.
Right.
So that, you know, that limits a bit, you know, what I could play there. But in other contexts and other parts of WICN's broadcast day, you know, certainly we would get some of those things in. Maybe some are not so much for the, you know, kind of prime listening hours and people are at work, and it's, we really want to keep things that are more familiar. But yeah, some of them, I mean, it's you know, just for me as an amateur listener, yeah, there's some wonderful stuff that's been going on from that. The guitarist, I find, though, just in thinking about this topic, having kind of, you know, come out from the blue, it is, you know, guitarists tend to be, they're very people with, musicians with very strong concepts, who have the, kind of have their own worlds that they create. Mm-hmm. And that's a, you know, Matheny certainly is, those are, I mean, it's wonderful stuff. And it is, you know, you listen to, okay, that's Pat Metheny. And there aren't that, you know, but there's not, you know, you've got this whole other world of like piano-based jazz in small yeah. groups. There are some, you know, there's a, but is it, you know, but where do you call it jazz? I think it's heading toward, the concept of pure jazz. Probably, I mean, I think really is being, there's a whole movement of younger musicians who's getting yeah. past that, and they're, you know, I think we're there's that, you know, you want to keep focused on that traditional kind of swinging, you know, familiar tunes, and some of the more modern, more the younger stuff. And Kamasi Washington's a great example of that, and some of the. Some younger guitarists as well. As you know, is it jazz? Like, you know, ultimately, who cares? It's creative music. That was the, you know, the ACM, the Association for the Advancement of Creative Music, right. You know, from 50 years ago yeah. in Chicago. But it is really, it's creative music, and that's a lot of what's going on. The guitar has a tremendous ability to, you know, define that with a very broad sonic palette. So, you can get, especially on using amplification. Go ahead, Jason.
Yeah, I mean, the guitar is also a very common instrument all around the world and in different,
sure,
different genres. So the thing I find, guitarists tend to have a toe in a lot of different, or maybe it's just me.
Yeah, no, it's,
you know, a lot of different right. genres, just because you can, I mean, you get into playing guitar, you know, if you're a saxophone player, it's kind of more cut and dried, like what direction mm-hmm. you're gonna go.
Yeah.
You know, you might go more Coleman Hawkins than John Coltrane, but mm-hmm. but like that's such a, you know. Yeah.
It's
the guitar has been so.
It's a saxophone.
Yeah, the guitar is so prevalent in so many strong mm-hmm. styles around the world that it's easy mm-hmm. to get pulled in a lot of different directions. Mm-hmm. You know, say you think you're a jazz player and suddenly you get into playing mm-hmm. Brazilian music and classical music, and you still want to play like Jimi Hendrix, and you still want, you know,
yeah.
like you know, and that's what a lot of us do. We like do a lot of different mm-hmm. styles, because the guitar crosses a lot of genre boundaries, and then try to bring those elements back in, you know.
I want to ask something that Tom mentioned and have everybody pick up on is, you mentioned, well, first we talked about Wes Montgomery and the way he played, and I think anybody in one measure knows if it's Wes Montgomery when they're hearing it on the radio. Or
if he's playing octaves.
Or well, that, yes, exactly. Or that somebody who was influenced by Wes Montgomery. Yeah, he used to do that. But then you mentioned today Pat Metheny. You instantly know that's Pat Metheny. Is that really true broadly? And are there players today who have been influenced by people who are still playing, like Pat Metheny? Can you, Jason, could probably identify Pat Metheny in a second.
Oh, sure. I mean, there's always.
But are there other people? Other
yeah, like every 10 or 15 years, there's a dominant voice, and then a bunch of guys who are obviously influenced by.
Yeah,
it.
But are they doing that? Because all these innovative.
Yeah, I mean,
people
Kurt Rosenwinkel
today,
is a guy like, he, you go to New York, and there's a whole crop of people who are really obviously coming out of how he started sounding in the 90s.
Okay, so that's.
You know, so it's it continues. I mean, that's
still happening. Good.
It's still happening. Yeah. And, you know, and then Julian Lodge, where I mentioned, I mean, Julian just sounds like Julian. He's kind of.
Perhaps too young to have a bunch of followers yet. No, but right?
I don't think any of us could hang with him, man. I don't. He's like, I heard him when he was 14, and he was hands down the best jazz guitar player I'd ever heard. And then he went and got into like playing a bunch of bluegrass and brought in this Americana thing and got into Eddie Lang recordings. He keeps like grabbing stuff, and his sound keeps developing. But yeah, he's.
So in terms of sound that are keeping developing, Eli, I know your roots are deeply in the traditional jazz scene. Do you the guitar players who have influenced you both on the Black Eagles and your current band, do you see anybody making that kind of music today, or is it all, are we pulling things out of museums? How do you see the influence still happening today? I know you could light a fire here with that comment.
No, as I'm listening to this discussion, I do wish that the viewers could possibly hear the music that we're talking about.
Yeah, right. Absolutely.
And unfortunately, the words don't quite capture its urgency and beauty and penetrating emotional impacts. But since you mentioned the kind of music where I started, I also wanted to draw people's attention to what you hear today and where you can hear it. And unfortunately, it's mainly in sub-Saharan Africa that one hears some of the most swinging, revelatory music on instruments like the kora, which is a calabash with a stick attached to it and multiple strings which are played with both fingers. And my last real-time exposure to kora playing was when my wife Carolyn and I returned to West Africa among one of many trips that we've made, but we visited the country called Mali, M-A-L-I, where Lionel Bouquet, who is a great contemporary kora player who's recorded with some American musicians, is from, but where in the villages you still hear kora played. And in Africa, the music isn't an art form. It's not people recording and, you know, performing in auditoriums or at festivals. This is really woven into village life. And it is inextricable both with dance and with praise singing or oral history. From the point of view of music, for those of us, and that counts all of us, who want to hear music where this your toes gotta tap. For me, as a practicing musician, when I first went there in 1967 as a Peace Corps doctor in what was then Upper Volta, today Burkina Faso, adjacent to this country of Mali, what was astounding was to go to the local market in the town of Ouagadougou and hear people busking in the market. And there were very often string players, balafone, which is a sort of primitive pentatonic xylophone, and more recently listening to kora virtuosos in Mali. For somebody with a jazz head, one of the things that you try to do is to locate the downbeat. It's almost impossible in Africa to locate a downbeat, because it's all anticipations. Right. And it swings like the blazes, and it is layered. And it's a music of such urgency and also such sublime sophistication that respect must be paid, especially when one considers the roots of jazz.
Yes.
And so what was going on in New Orleans at the turn of the century, where there came to be a fusion of African, Haitian, African slave work songs and spirituals affected by the religious overlay of African spiritualism, and then ultimately with the infusion of European influences in a sophisticated environment and the infusion of musical instruments that went along with the parades. And here, with respect, Jason, I would suggest that there was some guitar playing prior to Eddie Lang that had power. I have in mind especially Johnny St. Cyr, who played with Louis Armstrong in those celebrated late 20s recordings, the Hot Five and Hot Seven. So, again, we can't hear this in this environment, but certainly all of you are aware of Potato Head Blues, which, was Armstrong's amazing virtuosic performance that no one can quite imitate, although everybody tries. It's that one that begins da 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 da, and it ends with this astounding rip up to a high C and then a descending chromatic. It's utterly brilliant and was dazzling that it came out when it did and still dazzles people today. It could not have happened without a solo lead up by a guitarist playing just a simple chord background, beautifully transparent, leading into a stop chorus. And Armstrong, in the course of that buildup, was contemplating, and then of course inventing as he went, this astounding improvisation on the song that he actually wrote. Importantly as well, at this time, Jelly Roll Morton, a very important figure in the development of jazz, claimed to be the inventor of jazz, right, a pianist, but who had a kind of orchestral concept of the piano, and then in his Red Hot Peppers, allocated solo lines, and then literally notated certain solos, particularly for banjo, but also for other instruments. But my point here simply is that the plucked instruments in New Orleans had, how to put it, transformational importance. And prior to electronic recording, it was the banjo that could be heard. And so today, I mean, you mentioned Howard, we were just chatting about this before, Howard Goldman, he's a brilliant guitar player, but he's also a banjo virtuoso. And in my contact with him has been at traditional jazz festivals in Europe and around the States. Anyway, this is too long an answer, Ed, but I wanted to point out about the roots, lest we become too locked in an American art music.
Yeah, of course.
I learned in a music class in college that the four elements of music, melody, harmony, timbre, and rhythm. You know, basically that's the top to bottom hierarchy in Western music. African music really turns it on its head. That you have the rhythm and the pitch, timbre, are the most important, in a very broad sense, are the most important elements there. And in jazz, there's really a mix of the, there's always a tension between the two of them, and rhythm and it's why classical players can't play jazz. Is they don't have that. There's not that sense of the rhythmic, maybe not
well,
the
their concept of rhythm is very
concept
different.
Of rhythm is very that, different.
That's something I like to
play. People play in 15/4 time, right?
Right. Well, even just great rubato from a string section is a concept of rhythm. It's just very different than what jazz player, pulse music.
You get to it from a very different in a very different way. But the guitar, and just think about the guitar. It's all rhythm and pitch. It's very important to it, along with the notes.
Well,
okay, go ahead.
I think one of the things that is important to remember is that jazz might be the export, the most notable export of America to the world.
Yep.
Unique. It's unique to our country. So, but this is a world community now. It's not 40 years ago. And what happened 40 years ago is important. It's always going to be important. Everything you're talking about is going to be important. And then people are coming over here to study. Music goes over there. You can hear jazz right out of Stefan Grappelli in places in the world, Japan. The world is developing their own concepts mixed in with their culture, and it comes back at us. And it's just for us to be open-minded about and marvel and just, you know, love what we're hearing from everybody all over the world. And it, yeah. And so, no, it's not a dead thing just because, you know, it's an older swing style of music or anything. Yeah. It all is valuable. We just listen to the people who develop it because it's from everywhere, and just be happy about it. That's where the world is now, and it's just gonna keep increasing. And I think it's something to celebrate.
I think when we talked the other day, we kind of hit on this, the double-edged sword of jazz education in academia.
Right.
And it's an amazing thing. You see people developing encyclopedic knowledge of the language and the technique and the facility and there's nothing wrong with that. It's very amazing. The challenge is keeping in touch with what Eli's talking about, which is like the folkloric roots of jazz, I don't think the two are incompatible. You just have to have the right priorities. I mean, the first thing that led me into playing jazz was blues. You know, I was listening to Muddy Waters because my dad was listening to Muddy Waters, and I was like, I want to play guitar, you know? So that was the thing. And then there was the gateway drug of B.B. King. Yeah. You know, I was like, wait, that's a little different. And T-Bone Walker kind of led me to, those guys led me to Kenny Burrell, and the blues thing led me, because the blues is a big part of jazz. You know, and earlier forms of jazz were dance music. It was important socially functioning music. The thing that I got into was I got really interested in Brazilian music, and that led me to down that pathway and into a lot of other Latin American music. And you know, one thing that I liked when I was living in New York, looking around what was happening, the young musicians from Latin America now, to me, they were doing the stuff that I liked the best, because they were going, I mean, you guys like Yosvani Terry, there's a great writer named Emilio Soya from Argentina, there's a whole crop of Chilean musicians and Peruvian musicians. They're connected into like popular styles and folkloric styles, and doing this kind of academia level complex jazz writing, keeping those two things together, right? So there's the feeling of the folkloric, you know, very African diaspora music, you know, from Latin America, and you know the two things coexisting. And you know, I think of jazz really as kind of New World fusion music. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, the whole thing about jazz from the very beginning, it was styles coming together in similar ways that it happened in Brazil, similar ways that it happened in Peru and in Argentina, and this. And it's always been about grabbing a new sound, grabbing a new idea, and you know, having room to make that be a part of what you do. You know, I think John Pizzarelli's going to play a bunch of bossa nova stuff, mm-hmm. right? Because he has a record of that was, you know, jazz was flexible enough to just kind of grab the whole bossa nova thing when it came about in the late 50s, early 60s, and make that part of the sound. You know, which is thanks to guitar players like Charlie Bird and Gene Bernasini, you know, and those guys got, you know, but that kind of flexibility of the jazz language, of the jazz mindset, you know, I think is important for us to maintain.
Well, it's interesting you talk about the Pizzarellis, because you know, Bucky is a legend in the jazz world of an older generation. John is becoming same in a younger generation. Do you see musical influences between those generations? Are they two quite different?
In the case of those?
Yeah,
those
specifically
two?
Them, yeah.
Oh, I mean, completely. Yeah. I mean, you hear John, listen to John's radio show, and he always plays a tune, and he's like, "Ah, Bucky taught me this one while we were, you know, like learning songs." I think that's it's one of the things that makes somebody like John Pizzarelli so appealing to people, I think, is because he's coming out of an oral tradition. You know, he learned these songs from his dad, you know? It was like, "Dad, what are the right changes on the bridge to, you know, I don't know. What's the right change? And it's you or no one, or, you know, whatever. And he, it's this," you know, like learning it that way, like a whole
tradition. The main difference is John wears a tie and Bucky doesn't.
Bucky wears like plaid pants.
That's right.
Yes. Let me speak to that, sort of from a writer's perspective, but not really. Also rhythm section player, is all right, Joe Pass or Herb Ellis playing with Oscar Peterson.
Yep.
And so you're trying to hear what they're doing if you're listening, or you're a teacher trying to teach these people, and it's like, how do you play as a guitarist with somebody like Oscar Peterson? You just strum along it. I mean, that's an education in itself, no matter whether you're playing 50 years ago or last night or 20 years in the future. It's like, you know, musically, how does this all work out? And to listen to Joe Pass not only play it, but talk about playing with Oscar Peterson and how he changes playing when he would play with him, I think is something that's always going to be relevant, whether you're no matter what kind of music you're playing, even in a rock band.
I have this one memory. The band I played with for 31 years, the New Black Eagle Jazz Band, used to get good work in Europe. And one week we were booked into a jazz festival in France. We were there for a whole week, sort of playing traditional jazz in the periphery, and then one night on the main stage. But we had a chance to get to hear the big acts. So Oscar Peterson appeared with Herb Ellis one night. And I actually, and fortunately, we had passes where we could sit right in front. So I was about as far away from Oscar Peterson and Herb Ellis as that camera over there, so maybe 20 feet. And what was astounding was to watch Herb Ellis. It was so light.
Right.
It was like he was breathing along with Peterson. And they did Sweet Georgia Brown at about this tempo. You know, after a long sort of breezy introduction by Peterson, and they went into it this blazing speed. And Ellis appeared hardly to move, and yet played single string stuff, a few choruses, which was just brilliant. But it was feathery. I mean, it was, and it floated just as Peterson's sense of rhythm, and of course his astounding virtuosity. And this was back in maybe the middle 80s, where he was still at the top of his form. He put on a whole lot of weight, but he could reach the keys. And anyway, that was the thing that I remembered. I mean, it was mesmerizing to watch Ellis in this setting. And obviously he was enjoying himself. He was just in the music.
Oh, I never got to hear him live.
Tom, of all the guitarists who are sending new music to the station, are there any that stand out now as, I mean, you mentioned a couple, but surely every month they must bring a whole boatload of.
For sure. And a lot of, you know, a number of them I would say are just kind of, they're fine. But there's one that has really stood out is a young woman. We mentioned any women guitarists, but Mary Halverson is her name. And she is she's really got something going. It's very different. It's very original. She was started out being a student of Anthony Braxton, who is like up here for like almost 50 years. Very intellectual and brilliant saxophonist, composer, and all. But Mary was a protege of his. And so she is, and she's developed that through a course of, I don't know, maybe 10, 15 years she's been, but 10, 12 years she's been on the scene. But it's some very brilliant stuff that she's doing, and it's beyond Pat Metheny. But it's not easy listening, certainly, but it's quite compelling. Her brand new record is called Code Girl, And that was the nickname that Anthony Braxton had given her in school. But she's one that that's quite, I think, is not for everyone, but I think is quite remarkable music.
Be hearing a lot from her, you expect.
I think we are already. Yeah, I see that album a lot of best of the year lists.
She was on the cover of Downbeat last July.
This is a little unfair, but here we go. So if I were to ask you for your three favorite guitarists, would she be on that list already? And who would the other two be, if so?
Boy, I don't know.
And the other three panelists here would be right on the same
question.
You're
such a jerk.
three?
Yeah, three.
How about six?
Well, that's the problem, narrowing it down, I guess.
Depends on what day you ask.
Me, I'm the one who's not, who's just, not the guitarist
at all. Exactly.
Not really, pretty far away from it. I mean, I would definitely put Wes Montgomery on the list, and it would be Wes Montgomery, the Riverside period, Wes Montgomery in the early 60s. The earlier stuff, I mean, one of my all-time favorite albums is Full House with Johnny Griffin, which is one of the not real common instances where a guitar, there's a guitar and a saxophone really getting it on, getting somewhere together. And I think Montgomery was on the verge of, I think, getting into, going in a little bit of a Coltrane direction. But I think he got, I don't know what the history of him was, but he ended up in that very successful, very commercial music thing. I'm liking a lot of organ trios, which is one place where guitarists can really step out, and they're kind of, the guitar is they're not accompanying. It's really a triad of equals, organ, guitar, and drums. They can all crank up the volume. They can all just let go.
Right.
I was just listening last night to Tony Williams' Lifetime Emergency, which is John McLaughlin. It's just astonishing music from, I think, 1969. But, and also Hot Club type, revival type things. I mean, there's some really, really good instances of that going on. I don't think, names, I think everybody's, will name people and I'll nod my head.
Yep.
Well, you're supposed to choose three.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, I would say, Herb Ellis would be up there, and I'll put Mary Halverson in there.
Yeah. But and would Wes Montgomery be?
I would say
in
so.
There?
He's
yeah.
really. St- okay. I think over it's the years,
not
just
to have
my
Wes
listening.
On your favorite list.
He's just always stood out from all guitarists for me.
Yeah. Okay. How about you, Joe?
I can't possibly do what you said, so I'm going to cheat a little bit.
You're going to go five?
I'm going to have groups.
Okay.
I'm going to have groups that, because this is personal, right? So I'm going to have groups that I already sort of mentioned.
Yeah.
Because that's how it affected me. So the first two are going to be Wes Montgomery and Kenny Burrell, because that's when I discovered them connected with the studio orchestras.
Yeah.
And I never changed my mind, and especially after getting more into jazz and going to Berkeley and all that, listening to some of my close friends cop all their Wes Montgomery, Kenny Burrell licks, always, and then sort of take it from there. The second group I think has to be the group I mentioned, the R&B and English guys and Hendrix. So. Like Clapton, Hendrix, who else from that? I mean, Peter Townsend. That group of players.
Yeah.
So any one of those. Although maybe Hendrix is just he's so different.
Yeah.
So that group of players, and then my friend, the people I started to get to know at Berkeley. So and this also has to do with the people they played with. So Mike. Playing with Miles and the Brecker, Mike Stern, with the Breckers and all that, and they play with each other. And Schofield playing with Herbie Hancock but leading his own things. That group of people. So those names specifically, and then Jason. I love Jason's playing, and it's been a privilege to get to know him. And
why don't you tell them who my favorite guitarists
are? Yeah, let's try that.
No.
But I want to say one thing before you go to Jason and then Eli, is that you mentioned in that middle group of yours, I'm thinking that Eric Clapton, you could put Eric Clapton in a jazz event and get away with it.
Sure.
I mean, he's got those licks. He's, you know, you might get a few raised eyebrows from the purists, but...
He just played with the Lincoln Center Orchestra a couple years ago.
Right, and they got away with it. All right, your turn.
My turn?
Yeah.
This is completely impossible.
Sure.
Can I make two different categories?
Sure, yeah.
So there's a few guys that I would say are kind of... Yeah, and it depends on what day you ask me about my favorite guitarists. So, Wes Montgomery, of course. Yeah. So anybody wants to check out Wes Montgomery, yes, Full House is amazing. I absolutely love this record called Smoking at the Half Note with the Wynton Kelly Trio. It's just amazing. And it's not all live. Some of it's in the studio, but it's just like exquisite solos that he plays. I mean, I guess I'd have to say Ralph Towner is one of my favorites
these
days. I really love Ralph Towner. And he's like, it's kind of weird. Like, I'm always like Mr. Polar Opposites, you know? I love Ralph Towner, and then I also love just like Freddie Green and Herb Ellis swinging straight ahead. Major influence on me was Gene Bertoncini, who's a guy I studied with and worked with lots. Gene was in the Tonight Show in the 60s, and then he quit that because he got really into the idea of playing solo guitar on the nylon string guitar. And he did a lot. He's just got this pretty amazing approach to harmony on the guitar, doing beautiful arrangements of standards. But he also plays the pick style guitar and really swings his you know what off. But so, yeah, those guys. And then now, like contemporary, I mean, players around that really stand out to me. Peter Bernstein, who plays with a lot of different groups, really well known for his work with Larry Golding's trio. So Peter Bernstein's like a really swinging guitar player who's got this just impeccable sense of melody and clarity. You know, he's always swinging. He's always playing clear ideas, which I love. He's just great. Julian Lage, who I mentioned, who's just like up there for me.
Yeah.
As you say. And a guitar player from New York named Freddie Bryant, who's also a friend of mine. Freddie is also a student of Gene's. He plays a lot of nylon string guitar. Great composer. He just has his thing of, and kind of what I was talking about. Like he was really into Brazilian music. He got into Cuban music. He went to Africa and picked up stuff from there. And he'll write these tunes that manage to bring like the funkiness of these folkloric traditions or into his composition. So it's really good feeling, even though he's, you know, you can analyze it and it's deep and complex and everything. So,
yeah, as you were going through that list and given what you all the Latin and Brazilian influence in world music that you're playing these days, I wondered if there was going to be a guitarist in that realm that was one of your favorite. Then you got it with Freddie, I guess, really.
Yeah. I mean, there's lots of Brazilian guitarists I really like.
Yeah, yeah.
Yama do Costa, who's just this right. Slaying us all. He's amazing.
All right, Eli, you've had a lot of time to think about this.
I have. So I'm going to keep it simple. I'm going to keep it to three, but you may be surprised. Okay, so first of all, I have a grandson who just turned 21, and everybody was in up in the Berkshires for the weekend, and it fell to me to pick up the music that was going to last all through the preparation period and the meal at various levels of volume. But I wanted to do something that would turn on our grandson, who's a tremendous West Montgomery fan. So I put on Django Reinhardt. And on Spotify, you can do this play all number.
Yeah, right.
We listened to Django all day. And I think everybody else might not have been listening as acutely as I was. But I hadn't realized, first of all, the breadth and depth of his oeuvre. It's astounding, and it encompasses decades. But talk about octave playing with Charlie Christian. His octave playing was astounding.
How do you do that?
Well, that's the thing, because he burned one and a half fingers yeah. in a gypsy campfire when he was a kid. And how he did what he did. I think there's only one movie of Django playing. You really can't see his hands. But anyway, I've got to put Django first, partly because my head is still ringing and because it's so penetrating. And there are all of these Roma influences that you can hear,
yeah.
especially as he engages with his brother, the little-known Schuknecht Reinhardt, a violin virtuoso, a level above Grappelli in virtuosity.
Yeah.
And some of the stuff that they do together on classical themes, mm. you know, themes of opera and whatever else. It's just, anyway, so I put Django first. Second, and this has to do with the worm's eye view as a tuba player that I have of everything in the world, even though he's a bass guitar player and not a guitar player of the kind that you're all talking about, I gotta say, Jaco Pastorius
oh, nice.
Moves
oh, nice.
Me
Thank
deeply.
You.
Mm-hmm. Short, tragic life, yeah. but a vision mm-hmm. and a capacity for swinging mm-hmm. on the bass guitar mm-hmm. that, you know, and yeah. leaving his own sort of lasting yeah. mm-hmm. imprint. And then,
and his name, a very frank movie about him that came out about a year and a half ago.
Oh, I didn't. Oh,
yeah,
I didn't know that.
And his family authorized quite a surprising. I mean, the story isn't all pretty with Jaco and how he met his end. But it's if you get a chance to see it, I think it's just called Jaco, I mm-hmm. believe.
Yes. It is.
And
wow. I think
remarkably,
it was produced by the bass player from Metallica. I thought that was so cool.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Wow. Anyway, the last, and this is on the strength of one recording, which is Saturday Night in San Francisco with oh. three guitar players.
Oh, that's cheating.
But John McLaughlin played like there was no tomorrow.
Al Di Meola, John McLaughlin, and Paco de Lucia.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Paco de Lucia, Al Di Meola, and McLaughlin. McLaughlin's playing on that. I mean, I listened to it, and I listened to it again, and it was, anyway, sui generis, and I just mentioned it just because I was so affected.
Yeah.
Well, that's what it's about. We begin to think about wrapping up this. One thing that maybe is a little bit astray of the topic, but we've got four great minds here, and I want to talk a little bit about the role of music in education and beyond music education. I'm talking about the ability to teach new subjects that where the teaching of music helps people learning in all areas, especially the STEM subjects and also music therapy. And I think everybody up here has had some role or other in bringing music to people other than musicians. And that's probably unfair because we didn't talk about this subject at all, but I think if we can spend the last maybe 2 or 3 minutes talking about the importance of music in today's culture, especially in the educational front.
Sure. Yeah. So I've seen this from a few different angles. One of them is for about, 20 years or so, I've been involved in a workshop in Vermont called Interplay Jazz. Run by a saxophone player named Fred Haas. And one of the really beautiful things about that is we've had a lot of returning adult students who have either come back to music after successful careers as doctors or midway through mm-hmm. doctors, lawyers, whatever, or even started. We had one student who started, he's a pediatrician, he started when he was 41 playing upright bass. He could play one note at the beginning of the week, two notes at the end of the week, for sure. But anyway, just seeing.
And then taking his first gig.
Yeah, right. And then we never saw him again. He had too many gigs. But that's been
sort of a Viola story too.
Yeah. that's been really beautiful for me to see the effect that music has had. I mean, I can't go into the details and those, but watching a group of adults who have a number of them like very intense jobs, a lot of oncologists, a lot of, for some reason, and the joy and community, and I think a stress release that playing and studying music has given them, has been really great to see. And then of course, music for me is kind of meditative. It's even the, obviously the playing with people is exhilarating, the actual playing of the music is great, but every aspect of music is beneficial. Even getting in and working on the nitty gritty and the, you know, when I pick up the guitar in the morning and I put on the metronome and I play open strings on, you know, at quarter notes really slow, everything just kind of focuses in. My mind quiets down and all getting into the details of tone production, all this stuff is so centering. It's like doing a meditation. So that is something everybody should, you know, kids should definitely be doing it. You know, it's a fun thing, and the discipline that you need and the effect that the discipline has, I think has many benefits besides just playing music.
That's great. So I'm going to have to ask for short answers now, 10 seconds each. Anything, any one of the other panelists, because I know you'll take more than 10.
Yeah, I would take 25 comment. Minutes.
Okay,
yeah.
So that'll be the next show.
We've gone astray in this country. First of all, testing needs to go. MCAS, right out. Worst thing ever imaginable. Not testing, doing. Right, and it's not STEM, it's STEAM.
Right.
There's proven, I mean, scientific studies and everything, there's a direct correlation between math and music, science and music. It's STEAM.
Right.
It's developing the whole person, arts, just like it was when I was growing up.
Yep.
We've really gotten astray. It needs to, it's STEAM, not STEM, no MCAS. And there's 1,000 more things to say about it.
Glad I asked.
And just say God bless the people who teach, especially music in inner city schools. My friend Janetta Smith in Worcester, Vinnie Macrina in Brockton, who just they do miracles there. And you know, in spite of everything, they keep showing up. They keep getting it done.
Yep. Anything final, Eli? I know that you, as both a physician and a musician, probably your day job feeds into the creativity in the night job.
Well, I'd make two points. One is that jazz playing requires both intellectual and emotional honesty. You can tell when somebody's just faking and following the changes or whatever. But when musicians are working together and creating together, it draws one into, and in the presence of an audience, creates this transcendent experience where you're at a higher, arguably noble plane of communication with your colleagues. And high-level jazz players know this so well, a sense of connection where all of us are striving for a higher order of human existence. And you hear this, I felt it when I went to hear Jim Hall in that little club that he played in Washington back in the 60s. I sense it whenever I'm in an African village, listening to African music and seeing people dance and talking about their ancestors. And I feel it often when I play. The other thing is, since you ask, I could not have done my job at Boston Children's Hospital working on domestic violence and child abuse and constantly, unfortunately, often in conflicts with child protection people in the field who just couldn't understand the gravity of the situations that we were dealing with, or judges or my colleagues at Children's Hospital who were really only or mainly interested in keeping the beds open on the neurosurgery service. And I was in the middle of this for 30 years. Had I not had a regular Thursday evening gig right after my clinic, I could not have done this for 30 years.
Yeah.
So it does have that that healing effect.
Yeah.
But last I would also say, and this is one of the reasons why so many high-level scientists and doctors are also musicians, is that there is a brain advantage to playing music. We find this with the children who are in the Kids for Harmony LC STEMA program.
Absolutely.
In Pittsfield. You're a member of the advisory board, so am I. These kids' academic attainment as a result of a couple of hours of after school classical music immersion and some jazz immersion now, thanks to Ed, their academic attainment measured in every possible way, but also their television watching. They'd much rather practice a violin or cello than watch TV. And then the other thing is that in these ensembles, the children teach one another. And that's another thing that is nurturing of a sense of, how to put it, communitarian
values,
as well as intellectual advantage.
Yeah. Well, thank you. And on that note, I think we need to conclude. I want to thank the Mahaiwe, our collaborators, the Mahaiwe Performing Arts Center, our supporters at the National Endowment for the Arts, and our panel members, Jason Ennis, Joe Smith, Tom Lucci, and Eli Newberger, for an enlightening hour plus of guitar influences in jazz.